Hello, this is John Von Wurs. I'm the Director of Cloud Solutions here at SUSE. Today we're going to do a presentation on Kubernetes on the Edge and do a quick demo of an ARM-based implementation. Thorsten, why don't you do a real quick intro?
My name is Thorsten Kukuk. I'm the Systems Engineer at SUSE. I'm the Senior Architect for the SUSE Linux Enterprise Server and MicroS, and I'm leading the Future Technology Team.
Why would you consider putting Kubernetes at the edge of your network? Well, edge computing tends to be IoT type workloads with special requirements. In general, it's less expensive to put things in the data center or a cloud than it is to put them out at the edge. The three main reasons for edge computing are usually network related, which are latency, bandwidth limitations, and cost. Edge workloads need to run when the network connectivity is not guaranteed as well. You don't want your factory going down if you lose your internet connection. Now, going forward in the next 5 years, 75% of all data will be generated outside of the data center. And in many cases, that data needs to be pre-processed or filtered at the source versus being sent to a central location. As you connect these systems to the internet, you need to worry about security. There's a lot of malware out there now that's targeting IoT type devices. And it's imperative that you make sure that your connections are secure and that they're managed the right way. In addition, companies like Tesla have taught people to expect updated feature sets delivered over the network. The old method of installing firmware on your edge device for the life of the product is no longer acceptable. On top of that, managing thousands or tens of thousands of devices the old way is no longer feasible. You can't roll a truck every time you need to update a device or send a technician. You must leverage IT technologies to deploy and maintain these edge devices with complete security. Methodologies must be DevOps friendly to enable rapid development. You must be able to deploy the same way regardless of location, whether it's at the edge, in the cloud, or in the data center. And this is what containers delivers for you. You also need policy-based scheduling management to enable you to roll out patches and updates over time versus all at once. At SUSE, we work with several automobile companies. One use case for Kubernetes at the edge we're working on is manufacturing equipment monitoring and maintenance. The requirement is for real-time quality control measurements to avoid downtime. This helps transition from waiting for things to break to proactively scheduling their maintenance. Our customers are running SUSE Linux for ARM on industrial Raspberry Pi 3Bs. And interestingly enough, a good portion of our edge activities revolve around the Raspberry Pi. Our customers have built their own monitoring and signaling software with a touchscreen for their worker interface, and they do all their communications over Wi-Fi. The ARM system on a chip architecture is prevalent throughout IoT and edge implementations. We work with a number of edge equipment manufacturers that base their products on ARM core microcontrollers, with SUSE Linux for ARM running on the CPU. If you're considering a project, please contact the specific hardware vendor to make sure they have tested our operating system. This ecosystem changes rapidly, and there's a lot of innovation in this space. One of the components of our edge container strategy is SUSE's OpenSUSE Micro OS. This is an offshoot of our OpenSUSE Linux development process and is specifically tuned for containers. For edge architectures, a small footprint is critical as most devices don't have full-blown server class hardware. SUSE Micro OS is focused on performance at the edge and in container environments. We've taken the scalability and security lessons we've learned from enterprise class Linux and applied them to this new container operating system. Security is there by design. OpenSUSE Micro OS is an immutable operating system that cannot be altered during runtime. This provides the same experience every time a system is booted. Systems built on Micro OS are scalable because there's no configuring individual instances at runtime. Additionally, anytime an update fails, you can always roll back to the previous working instance. This greatly reduces the risk of maintaining your devices. Because OpenSUSE Micro OS is an immutable operating system, the file system is read-only. Atomic updates mean that any changes are made in full or not at all. The system will roll back immediately if the update is not successful. OpenSUSE MicroOS uses the ButterFS file system, which gives us very efficient storage and snapshot capability. All of the configuration files stored in the etc. directory are included in the snapshot and are rolled back if the update didn't take. OpenSUSE MicroOS is flexible, with no new package formats or size limitations on the partitions. Now I'm going to turn the presentation over to Thorsten to go through our demo.
I will now do the second part, explain the demo setup, and then run the demo. If you speak with customers, the requirements for the Edge are very often very similar. They want to have an immutable OS because those machines are very often somewhere outside and you need to send a technician to it to repair it if something goes wrong. So it should be very robust, reliable, self-healing, and for this we use OpenSUSE MicroOS with a containerized workload. Unreliable network, if you think about trains, if they are in a tunnel, then they have no network connection anymore, but the whole thing needs to continue to work. As we will use Raspberry Pis for this demo, and they don't have a real-time clock for correct time and date, we use an external real-time clock so that certificates and similar things always work. And the whole thing needs to be usable without an extra monitor. You don't want to have a big rack full of monitors for such few small Raspberry Pis, so you need an LCD display which shows the status and IP address. Demos always provide a lot of buzzwords, and of course, we also want to mention a lot of buzzwords so that everybody finds something he needs, he knows in it. So we will have Edge, we will have Kubernetes, we will have container, we will have HI and machine learning, we will have ARM, in this case Raspberry Pi, and for cluster management we will use Salt. The setup looks like in the middle we have a Edge gateway which is connected to the internet on the one side, on the other side it's connected to the Kubernetes cluster. It has a local registry from where the cluster can pull the container images. The Edge gateway can fill the local registry either via the internet if there is a connection, or you can fill it up with a USB stick. Then there is a load balancer, there is a salt master, there is kubikd, our daemons who coordinate the deployment of Kubernetes with help of kubeadm on a cluster. On the one side, on the other side, it's also used to manage the host OS. And the communication with the frontend is done via gRPC, which allows encrypted communication with certificates and role-based access control. So we will use Raspberry Pi 4 cluster and deploy Kubernetes on it. We don't need external network, but we will have a correct clock on all Raspberry Pis so that the certificates from Kubernetes works. It's usable even without a monitor. And we will use OpenVINO for HI, better the OpenCV and DLTT sub-projects. The hardware is a nice small tower of 4 Raspberry Pis. Each has 4 GB of RAM. We have an LCD display, 4 lines at 20 characters. This shows the status and the IP addresses, so if you are in a different environment, you only need to look at it under which IP you can reach your cluster. And it has a real-time clock, so that the Raspberry Pis have the right time always, the same. So the first Raspberry Pi is our Edge gateway. We will use an OpenSUSE MicroOS container host image for it, which will be personalized during the first boot with help of ignition and combustion. It has 2 network interfaces, the internal and external one, and the LCD display is connected to it and shows the IP addresses and status of the cluster. All services run as a container on this node, and Crony is used as time server, If the network is online, we will synchronize the time via the network, as we use the local external real-time clock. And of course, the salt master needs to run on this node so that we can orchestrate everything. For the Kubernetes nodes, we will use OpenSUSE Cubic images. OpenSUSE Cubic is our certified Kubernetes distribution. As host OS, OpenSUSE MicroS is used. The initial setup will also be done with Ignition. Ignition will set up the salt minions and make sure that they connect with the salt master. And it will use Kony as client. The containerized workload at the edge gateway is the most important part here is the local registry. This allows to deploy the cluster even if the network is flaky, or we can specify exact version numbers of the containers tested, provide them via an USB stick, and similar things. Then there is a repository mirroring tool, RMT. If you know SUSE Linux Enterprise Server, then you will most likely used already RMT or the older version SMT. This allows to update the OS without an external network. It can also be filled via network or USB stick. And you can select the RPMs which should be there. So test the RPMs in your data center by QR. And if they really fulfill your requirements, put them into the tool and then all the nodes will update themselves from it. We have a NAMM server to be independent of the network. We have a DHCP server to automatically set up the rest of the cluster. Optional, there is a web server so that you can provide the configuration files for Ignition via the network and not via an USB stick or something similar. And there is a script proxy so that you can allow access from the cluster nodes to the internet via access control list and similar things. Raspberry Pi CPU is most of the time fast enough for simple desktop environments. But if you do AI machine learning on it, then the CPU is clearly too slow. So we will use the Intel Neural Compute Stick 2 for this to boost up the CPUs. And there you need to consider some things. One is you need to teach Kubernetes about a special hardware or resource so that it will schedule the right containers on this node. Not too much containers needing this resource. So if you have only one stick, don't schedule two containers who need a stick on one node, but hope that there are enough nodes in the cluster which each have a stick and can then run the container. There is a Kubernetes device plugin available for this USB stick. Unfortunately, the driver is binary only and only available for Intel architectures, not for ARM. So we hacked the Myriad driver, which is an open source driver plugin, and separated it in two parts. There's a tool to boot the device if you plug it in. And then there's a plugin part, which is not doing the boot of the device, but only accessing it. The reason is that for some unknown reasons, this USB stick cannot be booted out of the container. To show you the difference between using only the ARM CPU of a Raspberry Pi 4 or the Neural Compute Stick 2, CPU only, a throughput from the benchmark tool from OpenVINO is about 7.5 frames per second. If you use a USB stick, you have 263 frames per second in average. That's a huge difference and worth investigation in special hardware. So at the end of the demo, I will show you a classification example. I will upload a picture to the cluster and will get as feedback what most likely is you will see on this picture. So in short, the demo, the steps I will present. At first, install the Edge Gateway load balancer on the Raspberry Pi 1. Also install the container services and the salt master on it. Install open the cubic on Raspberry Pi 2.4. Initialize the Kubernetes master node and add the worker nodes. I will show that it's really working with a forward hello cubic test demo. I will install the internal compute stick on the Raspberry Pi 4 and then run OpenVINO to classify an image. And now let's start the fun part and do the presentation, no, the demonstration. The first Raspberry Pi I want to install is Edge Gateway or Load Balancer, because on this machine we will run later the name server, the DHCP server and the local registry mirror, which we need to automatically set up the rest of the Raspberry Pi cluster and the workload. And now we only need to create an image which for a USB stick, which personalizes or configures the machine at the first boot. And this includes installing the missing packages, set up the network and a password so that we can log in over the network. We use Ignition for it. The easiest way to get a configuration file is to write a YAML file. In this case, we lock the password so that you cannot log in via a password, but only with an SSH key over network. We create some files for the network configuration, the host name. ETH0 is an internal network interface. ETH1 is an external network interface over which we can connect the cluster. The LCD netmon is the utility which displays on the LCD display the current IP addresses of the network interfaces. And at least we create a configuration file for Kony to use the local hardware clock and not the network, because we don't yet have a network, or the network is unreliable, not always there. So we don't want to trust the network, but provide our own real-time clock. Science Ignition itself cannot directly pass YAML, but needs a JSON file. We create that as next. Ignition is not able to install packages, and since MicroS has a read-only root file system, it's also difficult to install it during the first boot without an additional reboot, so that's why we use Combustion for it. We have a script, it's called script2, and there is a Combustion requires a network directive, so that Combustion will set up the network for us, and then we can install the missing packages we need for our gateway. Now we only need to insert the USB stick into our Raspberry Pi and boot it for the first time. After our Edge gateway is booted, we will now configure it and copy all needed data on the host for our services we run there. Now, the first time we log in, so we need to enter and make SSH happy. We copy the bind, DHCP and HA proxy configuration to the host. Additionally, there is a registries conf file, which tells Cryo, which we use for Kubernetes, where to pull images from. So in this case, we map the official cubic and OpenSUSE namespaces from the registry OpenSUSE.org to the local registry. This file will be copied to the salt directory so that we can later distribute it to all Kubernetes nodes in the cluster. Now let's log in. As you can see, root has no password, so we cannot log in with a password on the console, only via an SSH key on the network. Let's set up the local registry. At first, we copy the default authentication and configuration file to a local etc directory so that we can adjust it for our needs. Then we need to create a password. In this case, I will only use admin because this is quite simple, and from a security point of view, it doesn't matter here because nobody except me has access. But in your environment, you should of course use something more secure. So adjust the configuration file with a password. Now for what is this file? We have an RCL list. Admin, if authenticated via password, is allowed to do everything, which also means pushes images to the registry, new ones. Everybody is allowed to see the catalog and to pull images from it without password, so that everybody can pull images and use them in the cluster, but not replace them with something different than the admin wants. Now we have a second network interface. We have no name server yet running, so we need to add the second IP to the etc host file. And let's set up the container registry. Since no certificates are provided by me for this case, we will generate self-signed certificates. And start the containers. This will take a little bit longer since we have to pull them from the network. Portman PS will show us they are running. And if we list the catalog, so we see on the local host, we can access the registry and there is no image yet. There is a nice tool, Mirror Registry, which will scan the official OpenSUSE.org registry and use some regex to create a list in a YAML file which only contains the newest version of an image in the registry, in the official Cubic and OpenSUSE Cubic namespace. We use Scopio to sync the images from the registry to the local registry. In this case, we have network access, so we can pull them directly from the official registry and push them to the local one. For this, we need to provide the admin account and the password admin. If you don't want to have network access or don't have network access in your Edge area, you can also run the command on another host in your data center. Copy all the images to a local USB stick, go with the USB stick in your Edge data center or to your Edge machine, and then use Scopio to copy the container images from the USB stick and push them to the local registry. And now you can see that Scopio is pulling one container after the other and then pushing it to the local registry. Now copy it all images to a local registry. And if we list the catalog, we'll see they are copied. Now we can configure and run the name server. We need to tell the name server where to find the configuration file. And start the container with the name server. Tell our local network configuration that it would use the local name server. As next step, we configure our DHCP server. So ETH0 is an internal network interface where the DHCP server should listen. We start the server, and the last step will be to start the salt master. The salt master needs to run so that all Raspberry Pi cluster nodes can automatically register to it, and we don't need to log into the cluster nodes to do something, but we can do all remote via salt. For the nodes, we will use OpenSUSE Cubic, which is OpenSUSE MicroS with Kubernetes on top of it, a certified Kubernetes distribution, and it will be configured in the same way as MicroOS, because it's a MicroOS as OS below it. So we have the password and SSH configuration, the network configuration. We configure the salt minion and tell now that all Raspberry Pis did boot and configure themselves and register with the local salt master. We need to accept them at our salt master. This is for security reasons so that not an intruder can register its own salt minion and listen to what we do or send its own commands. Since we use a local registry with a self-signed certificate, we need to distribute the certificate to all hosts in the cluster. We do this via salt, so that we don't need to copy to every single machine, but salt will do it for us. We update the CR certificate. Normally this would be done automatically by systemd, but to be sure, we will do it additional or own. Also copy the registry's configuration file for Cryo and restart Cryo everywhere so that we are sure it really uses our local registry and not the one in the network it cannot reach. Need slice cubic D, our daemon we use to coordinate the kubeadm calls on the different nodes via salt so that we can bootstrap a Kubernetes cluster. We also need to log in on every machine and copy and paste the correct kubeadm commands. We need an HA proxy. And now we initialize the node RPE for dev2 as Kubernetes master. This will take some time. It's a single master setup with Weave as network and a containerized control plane. Kubernetes reboot daemon is used by us to do a controlled reboot of the whole cluster. Add the two remaining nodes and put them to the Kubernetes cluster. Now we will deploy MetalLB as load balancer. That is it. Now we have a fully working Kubernetes cluster. Finally, to see that the cluster is really up and running, we will deploy a Hello Cubic example. Machine, and as you can see, Kubernetes is up and running. Some more information about the cluster, kubectl get nodes, force our nodes all ready. You can see the three hello pod new services. And the full list of all of our nodes, pods running on the cluster. Since the ARM CPU is too slow for such AI tasks, I plugged in an Intel Neural Compute Stick 2 into one of the Raspberries. In this case, I used the node for dev4. You can see it's plugged in. Now, since we cannot boot this USB stick out of the container, we need a small utility which will do that for us outside of the container. So there's a service which will do that. And now the stick is booted. As you can see here. Now we only need to teach Kubernetes that there is a special node with a hardware extension. And for this, we need to tell it about it. So the script is patching the Kubernetes informations and adds a resource NCS2. the most important part is the resource definition here, which makes sure that there's exact one container per stick, because it's not possible that two containers can use the same stick at the same time. Now it's deployed. As you can see, there's an OpenVINO deployment running on node RPE 4.4 dev dot. We have an image, a script classify image. It's sending to the cluster an image. I forgot to mention. And that's the output of the container.
Okay, this concludes our demo. The results show a 67% confidence factor that the image that was submitted is in fact a sports car. We're ready to take your questions now. This video will be available as a download, and there's a link here that shows where you can get all the files that were used to create this demo. Thanks for attending, and look forward to your questions.